Amen. So how many of you have your Bibles here this morning? Amen. Let me see. Wave it in the air like you just don't care. Amen. We got it. We got the word. Yeah, if you got your phones, you can do that too. But we began last Sunday. We just explained a little bit of things about the Old Testament and just how the validity of the Bible and the beginning. We talked about the new beginnings. We talked about the 7 days and the innocence that the fall of man. So, and then we have the promise. We recognize where Jesus was in the Old Testament. And we began right there when he said, when the Lord cursed the serpent, he says, he promised him, he said, that even though you deceive the man and the woman, her seed is going to bruise your head. And we recognize Jesus was there. Now, let me ask you, does a woman have a seed? No. So he was prophesying about the seed of the Holy Spirit. The seed of the woman is going to bruise your head. Amen. So he was prophesying about Jesus right here. And so there we see a little picture of that. So now we're in the second dispensation. And you may be wondering, because you hear that throughout the Bible sometimes, the dispensation. Dispensation is really just a system of order. Okay? So this is the second dispensation that we're into, and we're talking here. We went through a little bit with Cain and Abel. In the beginning was the first marriage, right? It was God made everything what? Good. What did God make everything? Good. All right. Don't look at your life and say, I don't know why God did this to me. God made everything good. Amen. He didn't make you have those three baby mamas. Come on, somebody. Don't be getting mad at God because you got all this child support. That ain't God's fault. All right? God made everything good. And from the beginning, we're going to see, we have already saw, and if you haven't got it, then go back and hear that first message on YouTube. By the way, we're going to be having a newsletter come out, Sister Minnie, right? Hopefully by Wednesday or Sunday, and that newsletter is going to have everything that we're going to be doing. Hopefully throughout the year, we're trying to schedule everything. So if you want to get involved in evangelism and all that. But God made everything good. And now we're here in the book of Genesis, okay? The book of Genesis chapter 6 is where we're going to be at. And I just want you to look at that because these are the few things that have happened. Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel. And then Cain kills Abel. And then there you got the ark where the world becomes evil with the Nephilim. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about that. But the reason why I'm going through this, and for those of you that weren't here Sunday, I'm going to be teaching every Bible. Number one is the purpose and the history of that book. Number two is where Jesus is in that book. And number three, and how the book relates to you and me. All right? So you can come with that in mind, that every book of the Bible relates to you. And every book of the Bible has Jesus in it. Yes. Amen? And so we're going to learn a little bit of history and things like that. So I love this. This is a hidden message that is in the book of Genesis. And some of you may see it. So this is in the Hebrew and this is in the English of what it means. So you got Adam, Seth, Enosh, Canaan, Mahalalel, Jared, Enoch, Methuselah, Lamech, Noah. And these are every time God gives the meaning of the names. So this is what it means. Man appointed mortal sorrow, the blessed God shall come down teaching. His death shall bring the despairing rest or comfort. So man is appointed. These are different codes and different secrets that are in the Bible. So when you get in there, and then Jesus appears so many times, so you have to really understand and know when people would come into the Bible, angels of the Lord, sometimes they would bow, just like, for instance, Samson. When the angel of the Lord came, they tried to bow, and he said, hey, look, don't bow to me, don't stand up. But when the angels come and they never tell them to get up, then we know that's Jesus. Because Jesus is going to allow you to worship him and stuff like that. Amen? So this is just a little something with there. So if you would, I want you to turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 6. Now let me ask you, how many of you have already read Genesis chapter 6 like you were supposed to? Amen? That's why this is a read-along. We are not going to spend a lot of time on the scripture because we're supposed to already have the scriptures in us. Amen? So we're reading along, and I want you to look. The Bible says here that Noah was a just man and that he walked without. That's in Genesis chapter 6. And I want you to look at verses 9 through 7. All right? is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generation. And Noah walked with God. All right? And Noah begot three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. All right? So we look at here of what, I'm sorry, I put it's 7 through 9. And then, so the Lord told Noah, this is verse 7, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing, and the birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Amen. So real quick, the name Noah is Hebrew. It's a Hebrew baby name. The Hebrew, the meaning of the name is comfort. We just saw it. Comfort. So God brought Noah to bring comfort. And what's amazing about this is that, you know, in the beginning when God created Adam, the Bible says that he walked with Adam in the cool of the day. And Noah, and God didn't walk with anybody else but Enoch and Noah. All right? So Noah was somebody special to God. God was going to use him for that purpose, you know? It also says, of course, that he had three sons, Ham, Shem, and Japheth, of which were the tribe of Israel came out of. Does anybody know what tribe, which one of these sons that the tribe of Israel came out of? No Bible scholars, huh? Hey, no, it wasn't Ham. Shem. Amen. But this is another thing. I want to show you why the flood came. Because listen, the subtitle of this message here is build the boat.
Amen.
All right?
Amen.
Build the boat. And the reason why God wanted Noah to build a boat. Why did he want Noah to build a boat?
To save salvation.
There was a flood coming.
Yep.
There was a judgment coming. There was something coming. And there's a lot of times that God warns us about things to come, and we throw it crazy, and then we end up in a situation we don't want to be. Come on, somebody. All right, so the reason why was that the earth was corrupt by the Nephilims. Okay, real quick, in Genesis 6 you'll see that the Bible says that the earth was very corrupt, and that the sons of God, which were angels, they came down and went into the daughters of men. And there's where you got giants that came out of. Okay? Nephilims or giants or fallen ones. So the Bible says that they were all over the earth. They were all over the earth. And there was none just except Noah and his family. So he was trying to preach. The Bible says that Noah was a preacher of righteousness, that he would go out. Can you imagine? He's building this boat. He's building this boat and he's preaching. Preaching on the weekends, building the boat during the week. All right? So I want you to just get a picture of this. The Bible says also that that God spoke to Noah to build the boat, and he gave him instructions on how to do it. How many of you know when God gives you something, he always gives you the instructions? He may not give you everything right away, but you do everything by faith. Amen? Let me tell you something. I believe that when God told Noah in the beginning, he never told him that he was going to carry these animals. He never told him really how big it was. He just said, you're going to build a boat. You're going to build a boat. So these are just things that I want you to see. And we're going to get more into it, a little more detail. So I'm trying not to go too fast, because I'm giving you the history and the purpose so I can get into where Christ is and how this relates to you. Because that's my favorite part. Amen? So God was bringing the floodwaters on the earth. And you build this boat so that you would be able to withstand the waters. Amen? You'll be able to withstand. Okay? So, everything that God brings to us, you know, the boat was a vehicle. Yeah. Amen? It was a vehicle to get him into safety.
Yes.
All right? It's a vehicle. Every time the church, the building itself is a vehicle to get people saved. It's a vehicle. We can go out and evangelize. We can do this. But he had them build the boat just like he has us in a building. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
We are the temple of the Holy Spirit, but these are vehicles, right?
Yes.
Money is a vehicle that people use to preach the gospel, right? It's a vehicle. It's not a means for you to live necessarily, okay? So I just want you to get those. Noah was saved. His family was saved. And the animals were saved. Everyone else died, but God gave them a new beginning. He made a covenant with Noah, all right, to never destroy the earth by flood. Anybody know the sign of that covenant? Say that again. It's not homosexuality. That's not their sign. That's a sign of God's love and of God's promise. Amen? Like I've told you before, it doesn't matter if a person is homosexual, we still love them. Just like we love adulterers and murderers, we're going to love people where they are. Amen? But you see, when you encounter Christ, you don't want to stay there. You want to live for God. You want to obey God. So there's no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus that don't walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. We don't walk in condemnation. We walk in love. Amen? Because we know that love never fails. Love will change a person right where they are. Amen? There are many people that are sitting here today that have been transformed by the love and power of God. Amen? Hallelujah. So that was God's covenant with humanity and of His love by not destroying all of humanity. Now, the waters lasted about, let's say, some scholars say 371 days. Basically, like a year, the flood waters stayed on the earth. So they had to build that boat in order to sustain them and the animals for at least about a year. They were on that boat for a year. They had to have food. The Bible says that God told Noah, bring enough food, bring this, bring that. Don't kill that chicken. We need him. Porque, you know, if he had a little bit of Mexican in him, he was like, no, we want to eat chicken. Tamales. But he didn't want him to go and kill no chickens or the hog or nothing else. Leave that pig alone. Leave it alone. So he wanted them to preserve everything and to bring it, okay? So Noah's first mentioned in Genesis chapter 5, verse 32. He is 500 years old. So when Noah enters the ark, he is about 600 years old, which tells me that it took about 100 years for the ark to be built. Amen? All right. All right. And you were complaining because you've been here for 6 months and you ain't seen nothing yet. Lord, I've been here too long. I ain't seen nothing yet. There ain't no water came. I've been waiting for the rain. We sing Let It Rain every week, and it ain't rained not one time, Lord. Noah waited 100 years. Says something about the captain of that boat. You know, I think about sometimes that, you know, our church, we've been 5 years going on 6 years, and you know, I'll set my heart and set my face as a flint to wait until what God wants to do, what He wants to do.
Amen.
Amen. I'm not jumping off the boat.
Come on.
I'm staying on the boat. Because let me ask you something. How many times do you think that Noah threw his hammer down and said, man, forget this.
Yep.
Nobody's listening to me. I ain't got no help. My kids are all small. Man, he was building the boat. They grew up. They grew up with a hammer in their hand. Come on, somebody. They grew up working. You know, I went to go help my son work on his car, and it wasn't a very good day. I messed up my phone and all that, but then I started looking at my hands, and I had dirt all in my hands, and the Lord just showed me, how do you think Noah's hands were?
Come on. Mm-hmm.
Some people don't want to get their hands dirty.
Uh-oh.
Some people like to just stay in the comfort place. See, I'm getting ahead of myself because I want to preach, but I'm not going to preach just yet. All right, so let's go to chapter 7, and this is where we see Christ, amen? Genesis chapter 7, starting at verse 1, the Bible says, then the Lord said to Noah, come into the ark, you and all your household, because I have seen that you are righteous before me in this generation. See, how many of you know that Jesus is the ark?
Yes, yes, He is.
And He says, I want you to come and bring your whole family to get saved. Amen. He says, I want you to be saved, and I want your whole family to be saved. This gospel is not just for us, church. Let me tell you something. You're doing things that are going to affect generations.
Yeah.
Amen. So we look at verse 13. I'm going to skip down to verse 13. On the very same day, Noah's sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and Noah's wife, and the three wives of his son, with him, they entered the ark. Verse 16 says that, so those that entered, male and female, all of the flesh went in as God commanded him, and the Lord shut him in. Who shut him in?
The Lord.
Don't believe that movie with Russell Crowe. That is so far from the truth. That ain't even right. They were using that movie to make money. That was it. But that there ain't no truth in that movie. All right? God shut them in. Noah wasn't over there pulling the come along on the lid, Japheth. Come on, Ham. Let's get it. They're coming. No, God shut them in. Amen. Let me tell you something. When you get saved, when you accept Christ into your heart, God is the one that shuts that door for the enemy. Amen. Can't come in to get you anymore. Amen? Amen? And that's another thing that I want you to see. But let me go. Let me see what verse 23, what I wrote in verse 23 here. It says here, so he destroyed all living things which were on the face of the ground, both man and cattle, creeping thing, and the bird of the air. They were destroyed from the earth. Only Noah and those who were with him in the ark remained alive. And the waters prevailed on the earth 150 days. So it says the waters prevailed, but they still stayed on the ark. Okay? So listen, just real quick. So the flood, the judgment came. Why? Because of sin. Amen? And this is a picture of Christ, of just how God hates sin.
Yeah.
He hates sin.
Yes, he does.
And he came to destroy sin. All right? So the flood reveals that God is holy and he hates sin and he is determined to punish it with full force and justice. So the first and the second coming. How many of you know that Jesus came as a gentle lamb?
Yes.
He took care of the devil.
Yeah.
When he comes again, he's going to come to judge.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Amen? It's going to be judgment.
Yep.
All right? So, another thing. Just as God provides sinners with a divinely approved means of escape, so in Christ, God provides sinners with a divinely approved means of escape. So he says, get everybody on the boat. Get everybody saved. Get as many people saved as you can. Amen? Just as God patiently calls sinners to safety in his merciful provision, so he calls us to believe in him and to trust in him in his refuge and mercy. All right? God protected and saved those who have put their faith in him. Abraham believed him. He had faith in him. Now, just real quick, let me take you to, you got Hebrew, let me see, Hebrews? Where is Hebrews? I had a Hebrews up here. You didn't put Hebrews up there, brother? Okay, we're going to go to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. Go to Hebrews 11, 7 real fast. I want to read this to you just to show you. Hallelujah.
11, 7.
11, 7. So the Bible says here, 11, 7. And yeah, by faith. Everything was by faith. He says, by faith, Noah being divinely warned of things not yet seen. So just real quick, I want to tell you this about Noah. Nobody knew what a boat was.
Yeah. Come on.
Nobody knew what a boat was. He says, I want you to build a boat. And he's like, what's that? It's like before they made kayaks, if he would have said, I want you to make a kayak. You're like, what's a kayak? I mean, you didn't know what it was. So God is telling you, I want you to build this, and you never heard of it. And you say, okay, God. And that's the way Noah was. So he had faith. Amen? He had faith in what God was doing. He had faith. And he believed God. And it was, the Bible says, well, he said that to Abraham, it was accounted to him for righteousness. But when you believe God, it's accounted to you for righteousness. Amen? So let me go back. I'm going back here. So just as the flood purged the earth of sin, unrepented sinners and saved refuge take for a new and better beginning. So baptism signifies that. Okay? So this is another thing I want you to I want to bring so I can get into the meat of the message. But the ark had one door.
Yeah.
One door. One door.
Mm.
It's only one way in.
All right.
Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except by me.
Amen.
There was only one way into the ark.
Yes.
That's why that movie, that guy climbing on the side, there's no other way to get in. There was only one way into the door. Now, let me just show you how this is grace, okay? Let me show you how the ark is grace. When Noah was in the boat, and just say if Noah fell in the boat, he still was in the boat. So when you fall, when you're in Christ, you get back up.
Yes.
Amen? Because the grace of God is able to sustain you wherever you go.
Yes.
And that's why God came in the flesh to be able to walk and to die for our sins so that you can know there's always a way. So it doesn't matter if Abraham and Jacob, they were in the boat. They were saved.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
So I want you to just look at those things. And man, there's just a lot more symbolism in here. But let me get to building the boat. Amen? How many of you want to start building the boat? Amen?
Yes.
So this is how it relates to us, okay? This is how it relates to us. Noah and his family, God gave a word to Noah. He says, listen, build a boat. I'm going to destroy the earth. Okay? God has told you to build something. And every one of us in this room, we're building something.
Yes.
What are you? You may be building your reputation. You may be building your business. You may be building your job. But you're building something. But let me ask you this. Is it going to last?
Come on.
Is it going to last? Do we have that other scripture up there, brother? 2 Corinthians or 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 12 through 15. There we go. The Bible says here, now if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear. For the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. All right? Now, if anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved. Yet as through fire. So he's saying if what you build, it gets burned, you still be saved. But he says, I want to be in the category where it says, if anyone's work which he has built on endures, he will receive a reward. How many of you know that the boat endured? The boat saved people. The boat saved animals. How many of you know that everybody in here is building something? But I want to ask you, what are you building?
Yes, come on.
If what you're building is going to last, then God will bless it. But some people, they're so concerned about building their own empire.
Come on, good work.
You know, I would help out, but I'm too busy doing this. I would help. I mean, Jesus called the people when the great feast and the great wedding. I wonder when Jesus comes back and he says, it's time for me to take my bride. How many people going to be busy?
Uh-oh.
Oh, I can't go. Wait. I mean, think about it, church. We're all building something. We're all building something. What is it that you're building? Is it going to last? Is it going to bring glory to God? Is it going to reveal who Christ is in you? When God sees you, is he going to say, man, I'm sure glad you bought that Corvette, brother. Come on, somebody. There's nothing wrong with having nice things. But this is the thing. God's told you to build something for him.
Amen.
And you're not building it. You're not doing what he's called you to do. And so, if we can be honest with ourselves, and we can say, you know what, Lord, I haven't been listening to your voice, but I want to start listening.
Yes.
You see, let me tell you something. And don't feel like, look, I know what the world is like. Okay? It's easy to get caught up in the world. It's easy to get caught up in doing this and doing that. Do you think it was easy for Noah?
Come on.
Nobody listened to him.
Yeah.
Can you imagine? Just say this is his hammer. And he's building and he just throws it. Man, forget it. I'm done. Nobody's listening to me. They think I'm crazy.
Come on.
How many times have you wanted to quit? Huh? I ain't going to tell you how many times I did. But you know what? God is faithful. Because listen, this is the thing, church. And I want you to write this down. I want you to write this down because this will impact your life and this is going to help you that when you start serving God, this is going to help you to where nothing, no circumstance would discourage you, no people would discourage you, nothing. If you can write down the answer to this question that I'm going to ask you. Okay, we had a leaders meeting and this is the same question I asked them. Why? Why do you do what you do?
Come on.
I know what you do, but why do you do it?
Come on, good question.
Why do we come in this place to serve God? Why do we come in here and worship? Why do you volunteer? Why do you do these things? Why? What's your why? Because if you really know your why, then you shouldn't have worry about anybody offending you. You shouldn't worry about, you know, where you are, where you're working. And that's why we believe in this house that everybody should serve. We should give and we should save.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
What is your why? Because if you know your why, Let me tell you something. You can build the boat, and you can be in any part of the boat that is assigned to you, and you can work. Let me tell you, if you don't know your why, you'll get frustrated building a canoe. You see, some people forget about their why. They forget why they're doing the things that they do, and they get discouraged, and they get offended, and they get hurt because they lost their why. They lost their why. You don't know why. If I say, hey, sister, if this sister was offended, I say, hey, sister, well, why are you here? Yeah, but you don't understand. You don't know how she is. It's not about that.
Yeah.
Why are you here? I'm here to build this boat to save souls.
Amen. Yes.
I'm here to win the loss.
Yes.
I'm here to leave a legacy and make a difference. I'm here to lay a foundation. That's what I'm here for. Amen? Listen, I ain't jumping off the boat. I hope you don't. I hope you stay on the boat because look, man, you know, Noah was a preacher of righteousness, but I really think Noah was just trying to get some help to build the boat. Amen. I mean, he was trying to get people saved, but if he would have got like Manuel, oh, mira, he's a carpenter. You know, and the Bible, look, this is another thing I'll let you know just a little bit about the history, how a lot of times the history says that there were cavemen and there were uncivilized people. Way back over here in the beginning, the Bible says that they were skilled men. They were skilled. And from the very beginning, God created man, a sophisticated man, a man that knew what he was doing. Some of them were skilled in bronze. Some of them were skilled in wood. They were craftsmen. They weren't cavemen with a big old stick and a palo and you know, just a little. That's not the way that they were. God is a good God. He creates everything good. Amen. Listen, church, just like this scripture right here. This is what happened in the Tower of Babel.
Yes.
You see, right after the flood, God went to Noah and he told him the same thing that he told Adam and Eve. Now listen, mijo, be fruitful and multiply. Go out, subdue the earth, fill it. You know what they did? They all joined together over there by Babel and they started building the tower. They said, you know what? We don't want to do what God calls us to do. These are a prime example of people building their own boat, their own things. Babylon, they wanted to build their own tower. And what did God have to come and do? He had to come down and see their little tower, and he had to confuse their languages. Let me say, I hope God doesn't have to confuse you. I hope that God does not have to confuse you because of your disobedience. He's told you to come. If God has told you to come here, be planted here. If God has told you to go there, go there. Wherever the Spirit of God is telling you to go. Because if you don't, you may be confused after a while. Well, I don't know. It's because all these things are happening to me. I was here and then I went over here and you're confused.
Yeah.
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 And that's what happens when we're out of the will of God.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
If God told you to build this boat, help build the boat. Amen. Look, the Bible says in Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Come on, somebody. I said all these things will be added unto you. He says, if you make my business your business, then I'll put my business in your business. Amen. But he says, come over here, son, my daughter. Look, because you were created to do something for God. You were not created to live on your own. You were not just created to breathe to death and then die. That's not your life. Amen. Matthew chapter 7 verses 24 to 27 talks about the wise man. He says, I will tell you what a wise man is. The wise man is the person that heard the word. And when he heard the word, he applied it to his life. He was the man that built his house on a stone. The foolish man was the one that heard the word and didn't listen. He built his house on the sand. And when the storm came in, his house fell. The Tower of Babel fell. The boat lasted. The boat saved. The boat is somewhere on top of Mount Ararat over in Turkey somewhere. Amen? But it was used to save many people's lives. Amen? Hebrews chapter 11. Let's go back there. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 7. It says, by faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen, yet moved with fear, prepared an ark. You see, listen, when you have the fear of God, and fear, that fear does not mean that you're scared of God. It means that you honor God, you reverence God. And this is why, let me tell you something, it's so important that when you have a mentor in life, When you have a mentor in life, you take your mentor's word. But if you have a mentor and you don't listen to that mentor, how are you going to listen to God when there's nobody to hold you accountable?
Good word.
Noah, when you're a person of faith, you reverence God. You honor God. Amen? And he says he prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. He prepared an ark to save his family. Let me tell you something. There has been children in this church that have come that their parents used to come here. Amen? And they were preparing a way. They were laying a foundation. You know, whatever it is, let me tell you something. When you build something of work like that he was saying in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, you are doing something. You are laying something for the future. If what you're building, it should leave a legacy.
Today, yes.
Amen?
Yes.
It should leave a legacy. You should leave something behind for people to continue to come from it and to walk from it. I think about John Osteen. Amen? Lakewood Church. How many churches have come from Lakewood?
Come on.
What God, that boat that God used him to build, it's still building other boats. It's still saving more people.
Yes.
Amen? Hallelujah. I'm going to give you these are five things that I'm going to give you about the mentality of a builder. If you know, I want to see what's in your mind, and I want you to know if this is in your mind. So number one, they believe that there is a judgment or storms coming. Like I told you before, God sends warning signs to each of us. Would we believe it? The Bible says in those days that people didn't believe them. All right? 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 20. Do I have that up there? 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 20, it says, which sometimes were disobedient, whence once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a preparing, wherein a few, that is 8 souls, were saved by water. Luke chapter 17 verse 27, they did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. They went on about their lives like normal. They said, you know, that Noah, he's crazy. Noah, you know, can you imagine his kids if they went to school? You know, they was like, man, your dad's crazy. What is he building? He's building a what? What is that? I don't even know what that is. And he's building it so big, who's he going to save? And then they said the rain. They weren't used to rain. They didn't know what rain was. They didn't know what a flood was. But see, he heard from God. Can you imagine this man going out, telling people, his hands calloused, dirty, they have tar on them.
Come on.
This man, this captain, he didn't just sit by and say, hey, you guys do the work. No, he was in there. The Bible says he was a preacher of righteousness.
Amen.
And these people, they didn't believe him. So what if they don't believe you?
Amen.
Tell somebody else.
Come on.
Amen. Tell somebody else. Speak to people. Let me tell you something. I'm going to get ahead of myself. Look, number two, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but he's long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Amen? God does not want anybody to die. He wants everybody to be saved. Number two, do you have a mentality of a rescuer? Do you have a mentality of others to save people? Not the comfort, not the ability, church. When we're here in church, look, I'll tell you a little story. One year we went on a cruise, me and my family, and we got on board, and I was glad we were on board. But then I started seeing more people come in. And I was like, man, that's a lot of folks, man. And then they started getting on there. Then the pools got crowded. And then I was like, man, I wish that many people came so we can just have the pool to ourselves, you know. And then they started partying and drinking. I said, oh, man, I'm on this boat. I hope the Lord don't come back while I'm on this boat. You know, I was like, man, they're over there partying. They're over there drinking. And you know, I don't really want to hang out there. You know, I don't want my kids to hang around there. And you know, I want it to be comfortable.
Yeah.
But this is the thing, church.
Yeah.
Wow. I was on a cruise boat. It's built for pleasure. And so many times we think the church is built for pleasure.
Come on.
And we don't want to associate with those folks.
Come on.
We don't want to associate with those that got out of prison. We don't want to associate with those that are tattooed down. We don't want to associate with those that have that kind of past. I don't want to talk to sister. She's so loud. I wish that they just sit on that side of the church. Just leave me over here. You ain't on a cruise ship, church. There's too many Hispanics there. They should get some more Caucasians and some more African-American. There's too many. No, I'm so thankful. Our church should be diverse. It should have blacks, white, Hispanics, Indians, Asians, everybody. Amen? That's the way heaven is. Amen? We're not on a cruise ship. You have a mentality. If you have a mentality to save, Let me ask you something, church. If you ain't involved in building the boat, I pray that after today, you get involved in building the boat.
Amen.
Because listen, the vision that God has given us is so much more greater than we are.
Yes.
Amen? And God wants to use you to put your hand to the plow and not look back. We want to fill this boat up. Amen. We want to fill this boat up for 3 services. Amen. We want to continue to fill it and build it. So that why? So that people can come in and they can get saved.
Glory.
Now listen, we can go out in the streets, and that's what we do. We go out to the streets and save. But let me tell you something. There's a lot more salvations happening in churches than it is on the streets. I mean, when you go out as a church and do an outreach, to me, that's a church. When you do it inside of these crusades, that's like the big old church coming together. But this right here, this is where they're going to come get built up. This is where they're going to come get discipled. This is where they're going to come educated for the word of God. Amen? I encourage you. Get plugged in. Amen? And that's the thing. I had a lot of complaints when I was on that cruise. When I got to the room, I was like, man, this room should be a little bigger. Man, I don't know why they got it like this, and they got the restroom right here. You know, and that's one of the things when we come to church. Are we here to criticize? Or are we here to serve?
Come on.
Amen? Yeah, I know we don't have the lights like Lakewood. I know. Amen? Look, I was at Lakewood. I love Lakewood. I still love Lakewood to this day. But you know, the new beginnings is tough.
Yeah.
But the Bible says don't despise humble beginnings. Don't despise it. And did you know that Lakewood was a small church for 13 years? 13 years. I wonder how many jumped out the boat. Hey, sorry, see ya. I'm gone. I mean, you know, and so that's the thing, church. Even with your family, you know, your family started small. But so many times, men and women, they leave the marriage. It's too hard. I didn't expect this. I didn't put down for this. I didn't know it was going to be like this. I didn't know she was like that. Come on, somebody. Or he. Mira, it's not just us. Shoot, I didn't know he had all those skeletons in his closet. No wonder he came out of the closet. He didn't want to clean it. But you know, but that's the thing, church. Don't despise humble beginnings. We serve a good God.
Amen.
We serve a good. Don't be afraid to get your hands dirty, church. Amen.
Amen.
It's time that we step out of our comfort zone. Amen.
Yes.
We step out of our comfort zone and we start doing what God has called us to do. Where do you want to be when Christ comes back?
Come on.
You see, right here, if you haven't got your why, hopefully you'll establish your why during this service.
Yes.
Why do I want to do that? Is it not to save souls? Is it not to help the lost? Is it not to build up people in their most holy faith, teach them the word of God? That's what we're here for. Amen?
Yes.
All right. So you have a mentality to save. Number three, God wants to use me to save other people. So this is when you have your why, this is you know that God's purpose for you is to use you. All right? Don't be afraid to be used. Some people, they're beat down so much by life, and you think that God can't use you. You know? If you've been saved for some time now, and you still like that comfortable place, there's something wrong. You haven't had that encounter with God for that passion and that zeal. God wants to use you in a mighty, mighty way. You'll never know what He'll use you for. You'll never know, church. Let me ask you this. And the reason why I know that I'll ask you this question, you're probably not going to know. Have you ever stopped to thank the Lord when you're at the zoo?
Come on.
For the giraffe? the elephant. If you say, man, Noah, thanks, Noah. Man, this is beautiful, Noah, for your little chihuahua. I mean, you know, man, thank you, Noah. Noah saved these animals. Noah saved humanity.
Yes.
He built the boat.
Yes.
Now, if what if Noah says, you can't use me, Lord. Look.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, this big old thing, big old project. I just got three sons and three daughters, and I bet the daughters and I bet his wife, they all had a hammer. I'm gonna get that 2x4. I'm a lady. You know, sometimes I ask my wife to help me with something. She's like, you think I'm a man? I'm not a man. I bet that's the way that Noah's wife was like, hey, I'm not a man. Hey, well, you're all I got, honey. You're all I got. Come on, let's put your tool belt on. Let's get to work. Amen. There's times that people come in here, they need deliverance. And you know what? I say, honey, I need you to stay with me. We stay here till midnight, 1 o'clock in the morning. Why? We're building the boat. We're building the boat. We'll go back there in that room, and we'll be in that room. And people are just—they're hurting and they're beat down. The devil got them bound, and we tell them, "Look, we're not leaving here till you're delivered. We're going to stay here." What are we doing? We're building the boat. How much passion do you have to build the boat? How much do you really love people? We're building the boat, church. Let me tell you something. You see the elephant, and nobody knows the story of the elephant and the giraffe and the monkey and the gorilla. Nobody knows the story. But when we read the Word of God, we see that. Do you know the story of Frankie C. and Perla? That they met here, and now they have a beautiful son named Josiah?
Yeah,
if we would have never stopped to build the boat, would he even be in existence?
Come on.
You know?
Come on.
Beautiful couple, Hezbra and his wife and his family. They came and visited, his wife came and visited one service, and the Holy Spirit says, move back to Houston. They moved from Dallas to Houston. Why? Because they said, this is where I want you to go to help build the boat.
Come on.
Let me tell you something. It's just something, this is just something radical about people that would believe God that much. You know, he believed God that much to build the boat. They believed God enough to pack up all their livelihood and move to another city.
Yeah, come on.
What is that? The fear of the Lord.
Yes.
Obedience.
Yes.
What is God telling you to do? And you can't even just go down to Family Dollar and witness to somebody when God tells you. Come on, somebody. I mean, listen, church, we have to get it in our hearts.
Yes.
What is God asking you to do? What is God telling you to build? And that's the thing. When we come into the boat, I'm sure, look, like Ham didn't say, I want to work in the front, all right, Dad? I want to work over there. And then Shem, not, well, I want to work on the very top. I'm not going to work until the third level comes. That was a one level. No, no, no. They came to serve. Noah said, Mijo, you here? You there? You there? Adriana, you over there? Michelle, you over there? I mean, he was the captain.
Yep.
And that's the thing, when we come in, when you come in, and that's our motto for this year. Serve, give, and save.
Yes.
Serve, give, and save. We want to be a church that when you come in here, we have the heart to serve.
Amen.
God.
Yes.
Amen? And this is the thing, church. I'm not talking about, okay, it's for church, so I don't really have to call in. No, we have people of excellence here.
Yeah.
If they could say they're going to do it, they're going to do it. If they're going to be here, they're going to be here. Let me tell you something. When Noah got up in the morning, orale, let's go.
Vamos.
You know?
Tortilla,
go. They work. So that's what I want you to get. What are you doing on the boat that may help your child or your grandchild? There's a young man that comes here that his father used to come here, and he passed away, Brother Oscar. He had never been here with his dad. But he came back and said, my dad used to come here. He talked so much about this place. The love of God was in his heart. And before he died, he loved y'all. And that's why he's here. You see, you're building the boat. You don't know who you're going to save. You don't know who's going to come in here. You don't know who's going to change their life around.
Thank you, Jesus.
How many of you say, I'm going to help build the boat?
Amen.
Amen.
Woo! Glory.
Amen. Hallelujah. You know, he came for God's plan. He came for God's plan. And you know, we got to remember that, church. We got to remember what we're building. Because like I said before in the very beginning, We're all building something. We're all building something. You remember the story of the three little pigs? You remember that? One of them was building his own little house of straw. I'm building. The other one was building his house of sticks. And then there was the other one that was building the boat of bricks. Come on, somebody.
Come on.
Amen. Because let me tell you something. Just like the storm and just like the big bad wolf, he's going to come through. It's not if he comes through. It's when he comes through. He's going to try to blow your house down. He's going to test. If he tested Jesus in Matthew chapter 4, then he's going to test you. Amen. So this is the thing, church. How many of you just like to get on the boat and not do nothing? Come on now, be honest. I mean, when you're on a cruise ship, because that's when you're on a cruise ship. I'm here to relax. All right, don't ask me to pray for nobody. I don't want to pray for nobody. Hey, can you serve in the children's church? I don't really like kids. And kids don't like me. So, no. I'm just here to relax. I'm on vacation. It's not a cruise ship, church. I like to come when I feel like coming. I know I'm stepping on some toes. You're like, man, it's getting hot in here. I like to keep it real. I'm going to keep it real with you. Amen. Look, we're going to bless you. We're going to bless you. And we're giving you the word of God. This is all in the book of Genesis. Come on, somebody. I'm just telling you things you never thought of. I'm telling you things you never thought of. You know? When you look around, we have something to be thankful for. Why? Because somebody went before us. The Bible says in Hebrews 12, like I said it before, Hebrews 12, the Bible says that we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses.
Yes, we are.
And they're cheering us on. They're saying, man, Jaime, go. Man, Lucha, y'all keep going. We laid the foundation. Y'all continue to build. Y'all continue to bring more into the kingdom. Y'all continue to speak. Y'all continue to love.
Yes.
Keep doing it. They're cheering us on. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, all of them, they're cheering us on. Go look in Hebrews chapter 12. They're saying, keep building for the saving of souls.
Amen.
Amen. That's why I'm excited to go evangelize once a month. So if you got a bike, bring your bike on Sunday, last Sunday of the month, and we're going to go out there and we're going to ride for Christ. Amen. We're going to ride our bikes for Christ. Yes. Hallelujah. God is already working everything out. Oh, say, okay, so when God brought the animal, when he told him to build it for the animals, Noah was probably thinking, man, Lord, I don't know how this is going to happen. You told me to, all these animals, what am I going to do? I'm going to go find two giraffes? I'm going to go find two lions, two leopards, two. And he says, look, you just do what I told you to do.
Yes.
And the Bible says that God brought the animals. He led them. You see, you may be coming here, you may be single. You know, but God says, hey, I want you to be planted there. I want you to serve there. But Lord, I need a wife. I need a husband. He's coming. She's coming. Come on, ask Frankie C and Perla. They can testify. She's coming. They both got a word when they were here. But I'm just saying, you know, different things in your life. You don't know where the provision's going to come from. You don't know how it's going to happen. But God is working behind the scenes.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
I heard a story by Pastor Jonathan Stocksdale. He's a pastor out of Bethany, and he was saying how he was having a small group, and when he was in the small group, there was a couple there, and you could tell the woman was there and she was happy to be there, but the guy, he's like, he didn't even want to be there. And so the Lord kept tugging on his heart. He says, I want you to pray with him. So he was walking out and he was in the parking lot, and while he was in the parking lot, you know, Jonathan went out there and he says, hey, you know, do you mind if I pray with you? And he says, we hear what us Christians never want to hear. He's like, no, I don't want you to pray for me. So he says, well, that's fine. I'll be praying for you in my quiet time anyways. So he let him go, and he said, it was years later, he forgot all about it. But he was in a tour here in Texas, and he says that he was there worshiping, and this guy came up to him, and he says, hey, Pastor Jonathan, do you remember me? He says, no, I really don't. He says, listen, I was at a small group. I was walking outside. You wanted to pray for me, and I told you no. He says, oh, yeah, I remember you. He said, listen, I just want you to know that I'm serving here. I'm in a church in Texas. I moved over here, but I just want to tell you about that experience I had with you. And he said, what? You didn't let me pray for you? He goes, no, when I was really mad, I was really frustrated, and I didn't want to be there. And when you walked out and asked me if you could pray for me, and I told you no, I wanted to hit you in the face. And he says, But when I couldn't even lift my hand. He says, there was something that was holding me back. There was something that showed me that the power in you was greater than the power that was in me. And he says, I never felt that power. I never felt that presence before until that time. But I wanted to let you know, thank you for reaching out and being obedient to what God was telling you to do. You never know what God is doing. You never know. He's working behind the scenes. He's going to make things happen for you. He's going to open up doors that nobody can open. He's going to shut doors that nobody can shut. Amen? And so, don't be discouraged. Like I said, if you may witness to one person, they may not listen. Two, three, four. But maybe number five. Number five is the number of grace. Amen? And so you keep on doing what you're doing. Did you know that some of the animals weren't even born when he started building the earth?
Yeah.
Like I said, there's people not even born that are going to get saved because of the work you're doing today in building the boat. Amen? So these are just, you know, these are some things, and I'm going to give you some steps. But, you know, I always tell you that we're a local church, but we have a worldwide vision.
Yes.
And I encourage you, if you haven't subscribed to our YouTube page, subscribe. Because, you know, we look at our demographics, and we're reaching people in India, in the UK. We can see who's viewing our messages on YouTube. Amen? So if you haven't gotten a part of, go to our website. Look at it. Subscribe it. Share it. Because we're even using the social media to go out and to preach the gospel to the four corners of the world. Amen? So these are a few things to help you do all these things that I shared with you today. Number one, pray. All right? Pray. And I'm going to encourage you. I've been encouraging the core leaders ever since November. Ever since November, we've come here every Tuesday to pray. Tuesday night, intercessory prayer. I want to encourage you, the whole church, to come. If you can come one Tuesday out of the month, that's fine. We're here every Tuesday. Every Tuesday. We made it a point in our lives. You know what? Because the Bible, Jesus says, my house should be a house of prayer.
Yes.
My house should be a house of prayer. And it started with me as the pastor. It started with me. I'm going to be here. I'm going to pray. I'm going to be on my knees. I'm going to be the one interceding. And that's why it's so important for you guys to fast. Yes. I mean, we're doing this 21 days of prayer and fasting. Don't you know how powerful you could be? Amen. This is where you draw from. Look, if you want to continue to be a natural church, then you're going to operate with things of your five senses. But if you want to walk in the Spirit, if you want to do the supernatural, then you tap into that supernatural. Amen? It's there, church. Don't think it's a religious duty. It's not a religious duty. It's not just something that people do religiously. Jesus fasted. Was he religious?
Come on.
Amen? He did 40 days. No, you're overdoing it now, 40 days. Just water? Come on, you just want to show off. I mean, look, if you want more of God, go deeper with God. Like I said, this fasting doesn't make you manipulate God in no way. It's about you getting rid of all the junk in your life, in your mind, and to come clean with God. God wants to use you. He's speaking to you. Amen. So number one, you pray. Listen, pray for compassion. Pray for a heart. Because I know some people, they're like, man, I just don't want to talk to nobody. But you know, pray for that. Pray for whatever root there is, because every fruit's attached to the root. Come on, somebody. And so pray for that root to be exposed. Amen. Number two, love folks.
Come on.
Amen. Love people. You're like, I do love people. Well, you haven't told your face. Smile a little bit. Amen. You're like, I do love them. I do love them. I mean, smile a little bit. I mean, somebody might shake your hand if you smile. You know, just say, hey, how you doing today? Praise the Lord. Amen. Walmart. Let somebody skip you. Let somebody skip you. Let the teller know. The teller, if she's having a bad day, just say, you know, I just want to tell you the Lord loves you. I just want to tell you, you know, I know you're having a bad day. I'm not trying to, you know, do it sarcastically or nothing, but God loves you.
Yeah.
That's all you have to do. I went through a drive-thru one day in Shipley's Donuts. I said, you know, the Lord just wants me to tell you that he loves you. What? Thank you. And she just like wanted to talk after that. I mean, you know, you never know what people are going through, but just love folks. Express it. You know, do it in your actions. Take somebody out to lunch. Not during the fast, but after the fast. Number three, speak. All right? Evangelism, outreach. Look, this is three things that I learned. It says, Nobody, people don't need a judge. They already have a judge. That's the Father. They don't need a prosecutor. They already have that. He's the devil. They don't need an attorney. That's Jesus. What they do need, they need a witness.
Come on.
They need a witness. They need somebody to just testify of the goodness of God. They need somebody to say, you know what, I know, you know, you see somebody crying, look, I know it hurts, I know you're going through something, I just want to tell you where I came from. I want to show you where God brought me out of. I want to show you how God restored my marriage. Be a witness. This is how you build the boat, church. This is how you build the boat. Amen? And number four, last but not least, bring them. Bring them to church. All right? Bring them to church. I want to go fishing with you. Amen? I want you to go out. I want you to just go fishing. Because I'm going to go fishing. Amen? I'm going to go out and tell as many people. We go to the prison. That's why once a month, if you want to get involved, once a month, we're going to be going out. And we're going to be doing those things. But I want you to just take this word in. And I want you to help. If you've been here for 3 months or more and you haven't gotten involved, but you say, you know what, I want to build the boat. I want to get involved. If that's you here today, would you raise your hands? Just raise your hands if you want to get involved and you haven't got involved. Amen. Amen. So, I mean, you know, I know that Sister Mindy and Sister Melissa, do y'all both, they're going to have lists. And all you have to do is sign up. When you sign up, then we'll assign you somewhere. But, you know, I want to encourage you. You know, we had how many volunteers we had in the meeting? 30-something volunteers. And that's good for a small church. Amen? That's good for a small church. So the more people we get involved, the more impact we will make and the less talk we will be talking. Amen? We need our talk to be less and our impact to be more. Amen? So I want you, did you receive that message today? Amen. Come on and stand to your feet. Don't forget, after the service, you can get with Melissa and Mindy. They'll be here, and they'll be in the front, and you can just sign up. Yes. Amen. God is here. He met you here in this place this morning. You're not here by accident. You're not here by mistake. You're here by divine appointment. Just as God gave everything to Noah, He gave him the wood, He gave him the nails, He gave him the people, then God is going to give you everything that you need in order to do what He's called you to do. Amen? So with every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're in this place today and you say, you know what? I know that I haven't been living right. I know I've been running from God. I know I haven't been obeying Him. But today, I want to obey Him. I want to listen to Him. I'm hearing you, Lord. I hear your voice. I hear you telling me. And from this day forward, I don't want to disobey anymore. And today you want to get right with God. Well, if that's you, I just want you to put one hand on your heart, one hand towards heaven. Just say, Lord Jesus, I ask you today, forgive me, Lord, for my disobedience. Forgive me for running away. Forgive me, Lord, for not listening to you. And I repent, Lord. And I ask you to forgive me. And from this day forward, Lord, I want to help. I want to build your kingdom here on this earth. So, Father, show me, guide me, lead me, direct me. And, Father God, I want my life to bring you glory. I want my life to be a legacy to save others. And from this day forward, I declare and I say, Jesus Christ is my Lord and my Savior. And from this day forward, I'm not turning back. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Come on, church. Listen. I'm just so proud of you guys. I'm so proud of the beginning of this year. I'm so proud of how we started. You know, today is January 8th, and the number 8 represents new beginnings. Amen. How many people were on the boat? There was 8 people on the boat. It was a time of new beginnings. Listen, David's brothers, there was 8 brothers. David was the new king. It was a new beginning. I want you to know today, it's a new beginning for you. And I want you to start off this year of being unashamed. So listen, if you receive Christ into your heart, or if you rededicated your life and you're unashamed and you want to make it known and you want to make it public, we want to rejoice with you. Amen. If that's you here today, Come on, church, let's give them a hand. We want you to come up to the altar. Amen, hallelujah. Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All right. It's okay. It's all right. I know that some of you rededicated your life, and you're a little afraid. But it's all right. God is with you. Amen. The Holy Spirit's with you. You know, I know with all my heart that God sent you here to hear this word. And I know that you want to get involved. So right now, I'm just going to bless you. Amen. Father God, we just thank you today, Lord. I bless these people with all that is within me, Lord. I pray a blessing over them and a hedge of protection, Father, that wherever they go, that you would lead them and guide them into all truth, Father. Father, I declare goodness and mercy shall follow them all the days of their life. I pray blessings over them. I pray that wherever they put their hands on shall prosper and succeed. May you give them glory and favor and honor wherever they go. I give you all the praise in Jesus' name. And all the saints of God said, amen, amen and amen. Listen, if you want to sign up to help volunteer and build the boat, there are going to be some people right here in this table. Amen. God bless you this morning.